Brothers and sisters in Islam, in every khutbah, we hear almost in every khutbah the speakers in this masjid and in many mosques all around the globe. They read this hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which I will say it again so that we all can memorize it. He said, "Inna khayra al-kalami kalamullah wa khayra al-hadyi hadyu Muhammadin sallallahu alaihi wasallam." The best speech, the best kalam, the best talk is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His book Quran al-Kareem, Quran al-Majid, Furqan al-Hamid, and the best guidance is the guidance of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And worst of the actions are the newly invented matters in the religion. And every one of those new inventions in the religion are a bid'ah, are a deviance, and such deviances are misguidance, and every misguidance leads to hellfire, or ends up in hellfire, as the translators have translated. This is Nisa'i, volume 3, page 188, and also number 1487, and scholars of the hadith have cited this hadith several other places, from several other chains, and from several companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he has been seen saying this in almost every khutbah of his sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why so? Why is he emphasizing so much that in every khutbah almost he's going to say that? And that's why Muslims today, alhamdulillah, if not all, then many, majority of them says this hadith. The issue of bid'ah is a very sensitive issue in our deen. Because when we open up the literature, now the literature in our books, that we find out that we have some big names who ended up making mistakes. And they quoted this ayah of the Qur'an, this verse of the Qur'an that I'm going to recite in front of you from Surah Al-Hadid. ثُمَّ قَفَّيْنَا عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ بِرُسُلِنَا وَقَفَّيْنَا بِعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمْ وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْإِنْجِيلِ وَجَعَلْنَا فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُ رَأْفَةً وَرَحْمَةً. Waqf lazim here. This is according to the waquf of Medina. And then, وَرَهْبَانِيَّةً نِبْتَدَعُوهَا. The word bid'ah is here. مَا كَتَبْنَاهَا عَلَيْهِمْ إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ رِضْوَانِ اللَّهِ فَمَا رَعَوْهَا حَقَّ رِعَايَتِهَا فَآتَيْنَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Some respected scholars, very respected scholars like Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, he ended up saying that, well, this verse indicates that when people who started celibacy, let's get to the point quickly here, it talks about celibacy, rahbaniyah, or like this translator uses the word monasticism. Anyway, celibacy or rahbaniya was an innovation in the religion of Sayyidina Isa or Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, the sharia of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, because Sayyidina Isa is in the same nation, wa rasulan ila bani Israel. So they invented something new without knowing the background. Rahimahullah, may Allah bless them, forgive their mistakes, because the khair they have done to the ummah is so huge that, you know, we cannot appreciate that enough. May Allah bless them for this, but if there is a mistake that has been made, we have to point it out, or the mistake of interpretation. With this, some people took a support from this ayah, thinking that this allows the bid'ah in our religion, the innovation. Well, then we have to see that there's a problem, that why would Rasulullah ﷺ warn us against innovating things in religion, in the deen, in Islam, if this was the case? So first answer to this difficult dalil that they bring to many people, and then people who, the Amma, our brothers, myself and you, when we listen to this, we say, wow, the Shaykh has given a dalil. What do I do now? Well, we have to answer this bil-ilm, inshallah. Our Imam al-Shatibi, rahimahullah, in al-Atisam, page 291. He said, this ayah actually is an admonition. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry with them that they did not take the ri'aya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the easy religion, the easy deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them, and they went the other way and made their lives hard for them. إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ رِضْوَانِ اللَّهِ He said it means here that they should have had sought the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through tiba'a, through following, through obedience, through following the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not through innovating. Imam al-Shatibi rahimahullah answered this already for us. So may Allah bless his soul also. Now, some people still are persistent, and they brought a hadith on the issue of bid'ah. Famous Majma' al-Zawaid, Tabarani, also brought this. He said, Abu Umama al-Bahri said, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. When someone heard from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم directly, that's a very solid thing. He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَرَضَ عَلَيْكُمْ صَوْمَ رَمَضَانَ وَلَمْ يَفْرِضْ عَلَيْكُمْ قِيَامًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obliged you for fasting, but He did not mandate the qiyam for you. Okay. Until here it seems very good. Now, He says, but the qiyam is something that you have innovated. Now, be firm on this innovation. Like the Bani Israel, they did. They innovated something in their religion, the celibacy. And he recited the verse in there, Abu Umam. That I heard this. Abu Umama is saying that. And they could not live up to that task that they took upon themselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was upset with them. The wrong ta'wil here. But here there is a problem today with us everyday Muslims. That we end up quoting a hadith directly from a sahabi. And actually a lot of the translations are omitting the names of the narrators. Which is a very dangerous thing. Because in the times of Sahaba, in the times of Taba' Tabi'een, in the times of Muhaddithin and Fuqaha of our Islam and the Mujtahideen, in their time no one was allowed to quote a hadith just like that. And now we have the audacity to quote a hadith without even the name of the Sahabi. Rasulullah ﷺ said so. Really? Rasulullah ﷺ gave a very stern warning to protect his teachings. That anyone who said something about me and I did not say this, then let him reserve his place himself in hellfire. Let him reserve his place. It is that serious of a business. Now, when I read this, I say, wow, Abu Umama said, heard from Rasulullah ﷺ, okay. That means that if we invent something new in our religion, could be anything. Could be, okay, let's start dancing today after the prayer and make it part of Islam. And we have to stick to it. If you look at the meanings of this. And I cannot judge a hadith. No one should dare judging a hadith like us just because the meaning doesn't make sense. This is not the way of our scholars. Actually, whenever they heard someone said that I heard from so and so and he heard from the Sahabi of Rasulullah and he heard from Rasulullah, they're going to say, okay, let's find out. Let's find out who is this person. No other prophet or messenger of God. This is a miracle by itself. Answer to those who deny the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ. If hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ was not protected, our deen would not exist. They investigated. Let's find out who is this person, that how dare he says, I heard this Roman so and so and he heard from Rasulullah ﷺ. Let's investigate. Where did he go? How many places he visited? Where did he live? Where did he work? What did he do? How was his character? How was his behavior? How was his memory? Did he just used to quote things from his memory or he used to write also? All about him. Investigated that police and FBI today won't do this kind of investigation. Allahu Akbar. This is how our deen is protected. So this one, Zakaria, the son of Maryam, not Zakaria the prophet. He is the one who reports that he heard from Abu Umama. If you look at the whole chain. They said, actually Nasa'i, Imam al-Nasa'i, rahimahullah, and Tabarani, they all rejected him. They said, he is not trustworthy at all. So, this is off the wall. Rasulullah ﷺ did not say such a thing. I will never say it, because if I say it, that yes, he said so, yet I have a dalil now, I have a proof that he didn't say it, and I'm still persistent that he did say it, then I have to worry about my akhirah, because Rasulullah ﷺ warned about this. That's why in our history, you heard about battles last week. Those people, even though they were in the midst of battles with each other, they never dared saying a lie about Rasulullah ﷺ to prove their point. It was that serious of a business. No matter who is right and who is wrong. Now let's move on to another Shaykh, Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti, rahimahullah. In his fatwa, he has done a bahath on the topic of Mawlid, the birthday of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the 14th and 15th century. Two Jalalain, very famous Ummah was blessed with these great scholars, and they have done noble work that our actually students in the madaris, they are required to study the tafsir Jalalain. They're required. You can't graduate from the madrasa unless you read or you hear, attend the halaqat of Jalalain. Now he says, he himself admitted that there is nothing in the Quran, in the book of Allah and Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam about this matter, that we should be celebrating the birthday of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He accepted the fact that it is an innovation, no doubt, invented. But he said, because I see what people do, they do the tazkirah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they read Quran, they do good things, so it is my qiyas, he's making his ijtihad here, that it is acceptable. And he gave two references, and one of them is very critical, and I also am guilty of quoting that, but I quoted it in a different context last year. Riwayah of Muslim 1162. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was reported of saying, so to speak, according to the hadith of Muslim, narrated by Sunan al-Kubra, Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and Nasa'i. Imam al-Nasa'i also has quoted this. That he said, fast this day, the day of Monday. I was born this day, and Nubuwa started on this day on me. Very good. So, what I said last time, if someone wants to celebrate the birthday day, not the date, not the tariq, the day, al-yawm, of the wilada of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let him fast. But he has to fast every Monday then. Well, we know the authentic hadith that is very famous, that Prophet ﷺ said, fast Monday and Thursday. I like to fast the day when deeds are being presented in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Turba'ul a'mal. That is well known, authentic, sahih. All the people in the chain are correct. But he relied on his ijtihad on this. But unfortunately, his foundation is not correct, because this hadith is not reported that he has, the Ravi has heard from Abu Qatada, and Abu Qatada heard from Ibn Abbas, and Ibn Abbas heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is not. Abdullah bin Ma'bad al-Zamani, there is no proof. He has not heard this from Abu Qatada or Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for that matter. There is no link, disconnect. Now, because my sheikh says so, I'm not going to go around and start proving the thing. That's the problem with us today in the ummah. If my sheikh said so, then I'm going to be very angry. Brothers will be fighting the brothers, because my sheikh said so. Sheikh is not the Prophet. Allahu Akbar. Or he's not God. The only one who does not lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sahaba, they're guaranteed, and maybe those who are salihin. And here the problem is not a lie, here the problem is a mistake, and every human could make a mistake. No one is immune from making errors. So anyway, this is a dalil that he relied upon, but this dalil